Welcome back to the broadcast. I'm Captain Chris Nolan here ashore from Sea Semester as we follow the journey of the sailing school vessel Robert C. Seamans across the Pacific from New Zealand to San Diego. The ship is currently on passage from Hawaii to San Diego, getting so close to San Diego. The ship will be pulling in here shortly to the San Diego Maritime Museum at the end of this epic voyage. So in today's broadcast, we're going to talk with special guest Dr. Jan Witting and Dr. Elan Portner, a specialist on the deep ocean, as well as hear some from the crew as they get close to San Diego. So Jan, this voyage has been pretty epic. The Robert C. Seamans has covered a lot of water, but we haven't talked about one element of the ocean.
Thus far as the boat's been sailing, we've been talking a little bit about plankton and things like that at the surface. But of course, there's the deep sea, a lot more to think about. And the ship hasn't been able to, with a shorthanded crew, put out the deep sea nets on this trip. So we brought a very special guest, and Dr. Elan Portner, who is currently in San Diego, where the ship will be. I actually had a good fortune of sailing with Elan on a very different ship, on a research boat, but not that far from where the Seamans has just traversed. And Elan, why don't you tell us a little bit about, what your specialty is and how, about your research and your work in the deep sea?
Sure. So when Jan is talking about the deep sea, I'm assuming that he's talking about waters deeper than 200 meters. So a lot of work, the ocean is focused in the surface ocean because it's the most accessible. But most of the ocean, in fact, 95% of habitable space on the planet, probably more, is found in the deep sea. So deeper than 200 meters, where there isn't enough light left for photosynthesis, but this dark and relatively cold habitat has sort of produced these amazing adaptations of animals living in this space. And then there are also these diverse and pretty unique food webs that have developed in open ocean systems. So a lot of animals living below 200 meters are helping to funnel energy that phytoplankton convert from sunlight to chemical energy on the surface. They're helping to transport that energy basically to the rest of the ocean at depth. And the food webs and ecology of the ocean is sort of, at least from 200 to a few thousand meters, is sort of built around this this structure, this interaction. A lot of my work is focusing on characterizing the structure of these food webs, they're asking the question, who eats who? And it seems like a very basic question, and it is, and that is a pretty good demonstration of biology and in the ocean and oceanography, is that because it's such a vast system and it has such diverse animals and ecosystems contained in it, a lot of scientists are still asking fairly basic questions about, how are animals in the ocean interacting with each other? And then from that, we can start to look at variability in those interactions and trying to characterize and predict how the structure of ocean ecosystems are changing over time, either just with respect to seasonal variability or with respect to, interannual environmental change.
You developed a pretty cool approach, a pretty unique way of looking at the food web, not with nets, but with
lancet fish. So actually a woman who's now a professor at Scripps developed this program. Her name is Anella Choi. She's an assistant professor now at Scripps. And the idea is that humans are inherently bad at sampling in the ocean. There have been a lot of amazing advances in sampling techniques, but we're largely restricted to sampling from the surface. The research cruise that Jan and I were on was the longest one I had been on. It was 5 weeks between ports. We were practically limited by how much fuel we could put into our floating metal cork on the top of the ocean. So Anella had this idea that, well, why don't we just use predators? They're obviously very adept at capturing food. why don't we use them to look at variability in the distribution of their food over space and over time? So this project looking in the stomachs of lancetfish, which if you haven't heard of them, I like to liken lancetfish to like the love child between Cher and a lizard. And then it's, but then their baby is a fish. And what a world that would be, you know? But they, like many fishes that live in the deep sea, the temperature is pretty low and they're, like the water temperature around them is relatively low. And a lot of these animals that aren't top predators, like tunas or sharks, are not terribly metabolically active, so they don't necessarily need that many calories, which is a helpful adaptation in what is strongly considered to be a fairly food-limited habitat. So the stomachs of many midwater fishes sort of act almost as storage organs, as well as digestive organs, where if you encounter a prey, even if you're not super hungry in that moment, it will serve you to like get it into your belly and then be able to use it later. So basically over the last 10 years, fisheries observers on the Hawaii-based longline tuna fishery that targets big eye tuna, they have been collecting lancetfish for us, which are also very commonly captured in this in that longline fishery. And we've been dissecting their stomachs and quantifying everything that they're eating over this approximately 10 million square kilometer footprint of the North Pacific Ocean. And over, I guess we have consistent sampling for about a 6-year period, and we're learning a lot about not just feeding habits of this very abundant predator, the lancetfish, but also basically the biogeography of their prey that tend to avoid capture when we send nets down at one knot, like screaming, right? If you imagine sending a net down, it's like trying to catch, trying to like sneak up on something while yelling at it, you know? So it's providing a glimpse into these really abundant forage animals that are a part of a midwater food web that support many different types of predators, like toothed whales and tunas and sharks, marine animals that the average person hopefully cares about.
There are some pretty weird and wacky adaptations and some interesting looking customers in the in that food web. Do you have any favorites?
Sure. It's really hard to pick a favorite. What I will do is be a bit of a pedant. I guess it's not pedantic. The idea that the adaptations are weird and wacky is nice, but it's also, you know, if the ocean is 95% of the habitable space and has most of the animal biomass, there is nothing more earthly than adaptations of animals in the midwater, because that's that's who lives on this planet. But on that same vein, just because the adaptations are common doesn't make them any less amazing. I don't know, all the squids, all the midwater squids are pretty funky. I like animals that are clear. I think that a lot of animals, not in the very deep sea, but let's say between 200 and 1,000 meters, and usually closer to the 200 meter part of that, transparency is a useful adaptation, where if there's a teeny tiny bit of light, maybe better that the light passes through you so you don't cast a shadow and alert a predator below you to your presence. So there are some really funky, clear creatures. And by clear, I mean transparent, not clearly the best, which they of course are. I don't know, I didn't really get into comics as a kid. And now as an adult, I sort of feel like in addition to comic books, we should really just be feeding kids information about like the superheroes of the deep that have, you know, these like superpowers, but I don't know, are just making a living in their home.
Jan and I sailed together recently on a cruise track, and I was really impressed by some of the bioluminescence that was happening in the ocean. Are these creatures that are living way down deep or in the midwater or up at the top? Can you just tell me a little bit more about that?
Okay, so caveat is bioluminescence is not my specialty, but there are a few sort of pretty basic facts about bioluminescence in the ocean, and a lot of it we've just been learning in the last couple of decades, and even more recently than that. But it turns out that most animals in the ocean produce light. And I guess it's also not limited to animals. It's, you know, just many, many, many organisms in the ocean produce their own light. And below 1,000 meters, where like the last photon from the sun is scattered or absorbed in the clearest parts of the ocean where the ship is now or was 2 days ago in the middle of the subtropical gyre, the only light is produced by organisms. And either the animal has a protein that reacts with oxygen and luminesces, right, and emits light of a given wavelength, or they can house a bacterium that does that. So they don't produce the protein, but they house the organism that does. And there are some animals that, if they don't have direct control over when the organ is luminous, they will have a lens that they can, that's how they control the light, is by moving a lens in front of the organ that contains the symbiotic luminescent bacteria. So yeah, really, really common. It's a really, really common thing and has so, so many different uses. Yeah.
We just heard from the ship in the daily reports that they've started seeing some bigger, more charismatic megafauna. So they've reported sperm whales, and I guess that's a really interesting direct connector. Things that you can see at the surface that go down deep and hunting in this ecosystem that you're studying, right?
Fully, yeah. Sperm whales are toothed, so they're not filtering the water for small critters like plankton that the students will be seeing or would be seeing in, you know, surface tows with small nets. Toothed whales, like sperm whales, are often targeting larger squid that are found at depth.
Now, a really important technique, I think, is since place is dark.
Yeah,
and it's, you cannot really see any particular distance. Is using sound as a way to visualize what's around you. So you use a lot of those tools, sounders, sonars.
Yeah. So the idea here, and if you're familiar with sonar or echolocation, it's the same thing basically. Yeah, on this echogram, basically an echogram is a pictographic representation of that sound reflection data. So the colors on the echogram indicate how strongly whatever is reflecting the sound, how strongly it's reflecting sound. So the warmer colors, the reds, are things that are reflecting sound really well. That means their density is very different from water, and the cooler colors, the blues and the grays, are not reflecting sound very well. It's telling us that they're, one of the things it's telling us, excuse me, is that its body density isn't that different from water. So you can see that in this echogram there appears to be a pattern where you have sort of a lot of biomass represented by a concentration of color, sometimes lower down on the vertical axis and then sometimes higher up, and it seems to repeat and sort of oscillate. And on the horizontal axis, we have time or distance, right? So this is just, you can imagine the horizontal axis as the ship moving, and let's maybe do it here. So here's the top of the ocean, the ship is moving. And if you collect data for multiple days, you can see that there is a daily movement of biomass in the ocean. And it looks like a sine wave, kind of, a lot of the time. And that phenomenon happens to be one of the largest, if not the largest, movement of biomass on the planet, because billions of animals, of organisms, not just animals, all over the planet are participating in this migration every day. And the function of that, and it turns out that if the sunlight is located at the surface, right, only penetrates to 200 meters deep about at max, most of the biomass in the ocean, or at least at the base of the food web, is concentrated near the surface. So animals need to be in, animals that rely on that directly for food need to be near all the phytoplankton that are, you know, converting sunlight into chemical energy. And but it also turns out that most predators in the ocean use their eyeballs to hunt, and they, you know, they need some sort of light. So if you're up in the surface water, you might have more food, but you're also at higher risk of becoming someone else's food. So there's this pressure to move away from the light and swim down into the darkness, the relative safety of the darkness. And that vertical migration that happens, again, every day, is really helps to structure the ecosystems of the open ocean, where just because you have this sort of food at the surface, safety at depth, at least for the forage animals, the movement between them is structuring how predators are using a forage resource. It's helping the ocean absorb more carbon dioxide from the atmosphere because animals are eating close to the surface and then swimming away from the surface and pooping, and the microbes that oxidize the fecal pellets basically are releasing CO2 deeper into the ocean, and that's allowing the surface waters to absorb more CO2 from the atmosphere. So just this vertical movement of animals that's driven by the need for food and the need to not be food is also really important for really the ocean breathing, right? It's physically helping the ocean. It's a part of the biogeochemical cycling in the ocean.
Right on. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciate it. And it's really informative to learn about what's happening kind of below the surface for sure.
Yeah, everything is happening below the surface.
Next, we're going to talk with Cassie Sleeper, who you heard from on the satellite phone last week, about Cassie's thoughts on the vessel arriving into San Diego.
Hello, this is Cassie Sleeper, and I am one of the mates here at SEA on the Robert C. Seamans. We just arrived in San Diego from New Zealand. It was about almost 9,000 miles. We just got in about an hour ago, and we're at the dock. I have not stepped foot off the boat yet. It's been 70 days. It's kind of intimidating a little bit to leave this little vessel, but for the most part, pretty excited to go on land. Excited to walk further than 70 feet in one stint, and interested to see what it's going to be like out there. Kind of nervous, not really. I know that it'll all be okay. I grew up in LA. The first time I sailed into San Diego Harbor was on the Robert C. Seamans in 2004. On an alumni sail, and then the last time I sailed out of San Diego Harbor was in 2008 on the HMS Bounty. So it's kind of surreal being back here again, seeing everything, and it's great. But we had a fun trip. I think that it will end up hitting us later what we did. Right now it's kind of like, oh yeah, we just sailed every day and, you know, can't see the forest through the trees kind of thing. But I think when we look back on it, it'll be like, oh my gosh, we did that. It's pretty cool. But it's been great. I am exhausted. I didn't sleep at all last night because I never sleep the night before we get into port. I'm usually amped and excited and nervous and anxious and all sorts of things and wanting to get there. But we're here and it's going to be great. There's the Star of India right behind me. Beautiful ship. It's a submarine. Over here is San Salvador and Californian. Pretty great. But yeah, this has been awesome.
So a great reflection from Cassie Sleeper. And next we'll hear from assistant scientist Helen Dufel, who also made the journey from New Zealand to San Diego.
Hi, my name is Helen. I'm an assistant scientist here at SEA. We are now docked in San Diego after sailing from New Zealand to Hawaii and now eventually here. It was a wild trip and something I think we're all still processing. But one thing that was really special for me was the fact that we got to sail around the Channel Islands, which was a lot of fun because the first time I was on the ship, I was 15, back in 2010. I did a high school program with SEA where we sailed from San Francisco Bay under the Golden Gate Bridge down to Catalina Island. And I remember really vividly coming around Point Conception, and it was really foggy, and I must have been scrubbing the deck, and well, you could smell the whales before you saw them. So we came around the corner and we just found ourselves in the middle of a pod of whales. And so this time around, it was really great to be back here after 10 years. And we had a similar experience. It was a foggy morning, and then all of a sudden we had a whale breach so close, it was almost alarming. So that was really, really cool to just look back and see not only like where we've come from on this trip, but everything that's happened in since the first time I was on the ship. Since then, I went on to do a semester program in college, came back right after I graduated for an internship, and then been here for the last couple of years as a scientist. So it's a big full circle, and it feels really incredible.
Well, thank you to both Cassie and Helen for recording their personal reflections on this truly epic journey. Well, that's our show. Thanks for watching. On behalf of the crew of the Robert C. Seamans, Jan and I, and all the guests that we've had on these broadcasts, as well as the faculty and staff of C Semester, thanks for watching and hope you have a good day.
Thanks for joining us.